Today we're going to solve a problem that has plagued 360 photographers forever, and that is, how do you shoot a mixed lighting interior when you have bright sunlight coming through windows and your interior is relatively dark? How do you shoot it? How do you edit it to get the perfect exposure for real estate, for interiors of any kind? This video will answer that question, and hey, this is a section from my video course about virtual tours that I'm giving you completely for free. So if you got value from it, then follow the link in the description if you want to watch the entire course. I'm just going to give you a heads up now, to do this, you're going to need a 360 camera that has the ability to shoot manually. You'll also need a photo editing software of some kind that is able to combine several photos into one merged HDR image. This video will show my entire workflow, and this is a really valuable skill to have, because when you understand how to combine exposures into the perfect image, you can then do it with any tricky lighting situation you come across in the future. Okay, so you're at your shoot location, you have your camera in hand, and you're ready to shoot. The first thing you need to do is assess the lighting situation. How bad is the overexposure going to be? Is the sun extremely bright and the interior extremely dark, or is the lighting actually pretty good to begin with? This will affect exactly which method we use to shoot and edit our image. So I'm going to show you three different ways to do this depending on the harshness of the light in your room. This will also depend on the 360 camera you're using. Some have more functions than others, but most should have the abilities of the camera I'll be using in this video. So if your lighting is pretty good to begin with, if you feel like there's a good mixture of light inside and outside and it's not that tricky, this is when we're going to use the inbuilt HDR function of your camera. Some cameras are better than others, but this is the fastest way to get a decent exposure both inside and outside within the same image. Simply set up your camera in HDR mode, put on a self timer, and go hide. The best thing about this is you barely need to do any post-production on your image, just basic color correction and you are done. However, you will need to take a test shot, look at those highlight areas, and if there's still any blown out detail, then you'll want to try the next method. And that is shooting in RAW. If the contrast of your lighting is more difficult and HDR won't fix it, RAW is the next level up yet again. This is going to give us more manual ability to decrease our highlights and is especially good for any shadowy areas. So to shoot RAW, simply put your camera into RAW mode, set your exposure manually, get it looking nice, but also make sure those highlights aren't too blown out. It's better to expose for the highlights than for the shadows. The shadows are easier to recover. However, it does also depend on the camera you're using, so you will want to get a feel for your specific camera before you make a decision on exactly where you want to set that exposure, but in most situations, exposing for the highlights will give you a better end result. Now activate the self timer, run and hide, and we are done. The final advanced method for super high contrast lighting is shooting in bracketing, which means we're going to shoot several shots at different exposures and then combine them together later. You can shoot anywhere from 3 shots to as many as you like, and it does also help if you're shooting in RAW. You need to think of bracketing as exposing for specific areas in your room. So the first shot might be for the brightest highlight. You want that to look good on your live preview. Always try and keep your ISO low, so I would suggest changing the shutter speed to achieve these different exposures. So let's start here with a really fast shutter speed, so those really bright highlights are exposed perfectly. Next, I'm going to take a shot in the middle of the range, meaning I'm exposing for the mid-tones, I'm not exposing for the highlights or the shadows, but the tones and textures in the middle of the range. This will look the closest to what the exposure should actually look like. Finally, we're going to take one exposure for the shadows and look at the darkest areas of your room, and we want these to be properly exposed. So in this room, it's probably going to be the TV, the shadow under the desk, and a little bit of the bathroom. I'm going to slow down the shutter speed a bit, meaning everything else is blown out. However, those shadows are exposed very nicely. I know this image looks terrible right now, but the shadow areas look good, and that's what's important. Depending on just how tricky your lighting situation is, you may want to increase it from 3 to either 7 or 10 or more brackets. Essentially, the reason you would do this is if there are many different shades of light and dark in your room, you can expose each one of them perfectly and then combine them together later, resulting in an image with 100% perfect exposure. This is also going to help us with our window areas, because light will leak through and affect the window frame, because you have the really bright exterior and then you've got the dark window frame there. There's going to be light that spills in. So if we expose both of them individually, we can then get them to work harmoniously with each other. So there are two methods for bracketing. A lot of 360 cameras have an inbuilt bracketing setting where you set your multiple exposures in advance and it then fires them all off one by one. The other way, if your camera doesn't have this feature, or if you just prefer doing it one by one, is setting your exposure, taking a photo, setting a different exposure, taking a photo again, and so on until you've covered the entire dynamic range. Bracketing is essentially shooting HDR manually, so you'll want to make sure every strength of light is properly exposed. Take as many images as you have to until you think you've got all of your bases covered. Now let's edit. There are many different programs that will allow you to combine multiple exposures into one image. In this example, I'm going to be using Adobe Camera Raw within Photoshop. However, no matter which software you use, whether it's Lightroom or a dedicated HDR program, the workflow is exactly the same. Okay, so here we have our first image, which was shot with inbuilt HDR. And overall, this is looking pretty good inside. However, those highlights are still kind of blown out. So I can do a quick color correction to see how much I can fix. Let's bring those highlights down. Maybe the shadows up a bit. I've done a quick color correction here to try and fix the windows. However, I'm still not happy with this and I wouldn't be happy giving this image to a client. This shot is perhaps a 7 out of 10 in terms of getting the exposure right, and I really think we can do better. Next, I'm going to open up our single shot raw file in Adobe Camera Raw. And straight away, it looks really dark, but I'm going to bring down the highlights and I'm seeing more detail there. And this is going to take a bit of tinkering, but after moving a bunch of sliders, I got the same result as before, if not slightly better in terms of overall dynamic range. Now you can see slightly more detail outside. However, after stitching this image, I can say it is good, yes, but it's still not the 10 out of 10 image I need to give to my client. RAW is a really cool feature, no question. However, the lighting inside this room is too high contrast for one single image to give me a perfect exposure, which is where bracketing is going to save the day. All right, so here I've opened up my three bracketed images within Camera RAW. Here they are, 1, 2, 3, all very different exposures. And now we want to blend the three together into one image. The way we do that is by selecting all three, then we're going to right click and select merge to HDR. Now it's going to combine all three together as a fourth image on the left hand side. So I'm going to click merge, then I'll quickly save it, and here we go. There is our merged bracketed HDR shot, and that dynamic range without touching it yet already looks really, really good. After doing a 60 second color correction, this image is already a 9 out of 10. I love this image. I can't believe how well this turned out. The shadows look good, the highlights look good, the windows look good, and you can see everything that's outside. However, if you're like me, then you're probably not willing to settle for a 9 out of 10 image when you can get a 10 out of 10. And the way we get a 10 is by using even more images. So I shot my first bracketed sequence with 3 shots, and I shot a second one with 7 shots, which covers an overall wider field of dynamic range. So what I'm going to do here is repeat the same process as before. I'm going to select them all, merge to HDR, do a really quick color correction, and look at that. How good does that look? Can you believe those windows look almost like paintings hanging on the wall? The exposure is basically perfect. I love this image and I would be really happy sending this to my client. Something that definitely helped in this situation was shooting my bracketed shots in RAW, because it meant I had more flexibility later on when I was editing to bring up the shadows, bring down the highlights, and get the balance of the exposure perfect. When shooting JPEG, it's just more limiting and you have less flexibility later on. So there you go. When you're shooting your next interior, you'll have 3 tools to choose from: inbuilt HDR, shooting single shot RAW, and then bracketed RAW. Depending on the harshness of the light coming through the windows, you've got options to cover all bases. When shooting 360s professionally, it's really important you get your exposure right. If you're shooting virtual tours for paid clients, they won't be too happy if the windows are completely bright when there might be something nice outside that would be worth seeing, which is why the bracketing technique is definitely going to be worth your time. Yes, it is a little bit more post-production work, but it's completely worth it to get your image from a 7 out of 10 to a 10 out of 10. I'd strongly suggest you practice all three of these techniques and the workflow behind it. Once you get really good, you'll be able to take amazing photos inside difficult lighting situations like this really quickly. So depending on the camera you own, the workflow might be slightly different. So it helps to practice and practice, because when you show up for your client, you'll be able to do it really fast and give them an awesome result. Cool, well, I hope you enjoyed the lesson. If you got value from it, this is nothing compared to what you will learn in my video course about virtual tours. It covers everything you need to know, from planning your virtual tour shoot to shooting like we've just done here. We'll cover a lot more shooting techniques in depth in the course, as well as post-production. I have a lengthy post-production section that teaches all of my best secrets for getting amazing results in post-production. And then the most important thing: how do you make money from your work? How do you sell yourself, get clients, and create a business out of it? Because look, it's really nice to be able to take pretty photos, but if you're looking to shoot virtual tours, you're probably wanting to make money from your work so it becomes a sustainable thing for you, which is why I added a big section about doing business, getting clients, and making money from your virtual tours. Put a link to it down there, so if you want to learn more, then be sure to pick up your copy today. Cool, well, that's all from me. Leave a like if you like this video and hit that subscribe button for more awesome virtual tour content coming really soon. And with that, the sun is out, the birds are chirping, I'm gonna go shoot me some 360. I'll see you in the next video.